Ever since the Mass Effect Trilogy remake was announced, fans and myself have been dying to know just how in-depth a reimagining we were going to get. Would it be a ground-up overhaul like Activision and Capcom's remakes, or more of a remaster where textures get reworked but the meat of the experience, the feel of the game, remains the same? Turns out it's a bit of both, and as I was lucky enough to sit down with BioWare as part of a livestream gameplay reveal and Q&A session, here's everything that stood out to me as a lifelong Mass Effect fan. I'm joined by Josh Brown to break all of this stuff down, because there's so many individual details that I just needed to yell at his face.
Right then, Josh Brown, I'm literally going to tell you the coolest things because there's so much to get through. And I think that it's kind of awesome how much BioWare have done to the original Mass Effect 1. I remember last year when they said that they were delaying, the Legendary Edition because Mass Effect 1 needed the most work. That absolutely came through in the stuff that they showed me. And I don't feel like it comes through in the trailer. The trailer will be live by now, hopefully. And I think a lot of people are going to look at that and go, oh, they just kind of reskinned it. It's not enough. And so the stuff that stood out to me sitting as a big Mass Effect fan in this Q&A session thing, is that they have overhauled Mass Effect 1. They actually showed us this sort of working prototype of Mass Effect 1 that plays more like Mass Effect 2. They said that it now has the cover system for Mass Effect 2 and 3. It has tighter aiming controls. The general movement is like 2 and 3. And there's a dedicated melee button. They didn't talk about the back button being the grenade button.
I was just about to ask.
I know, so the jury is out on that. But they also said that they've removed class-based weapon restrictions, so you can just, it's not anymore where you're stuck to a pistol and a shotgun or you're stuck to a sniper, so you can try everything. The UI is overhauled. The HUD from 2 and 3 is now in 1, so everything just looks the same throughout the trilogy, which is awesome. They've also removed or made skippable the elevators, which were always... I never minded them, back in the day, because I was always like, that's a little bit of character dialogue. It's kind of cool. Depends on who you're bringing on the mission. But they said that obviously they understand people don't like sitting in the elevators for 30, 45 seconds. So you can skip them now. They're just totally skippable just because new hardware gets around that stuff. There's a lot of stuff, but before I let you breathe, there's one more thing in that they've got entire new Commander Shepard models in Mass Effect 1, including on the female side, the sort of iconic Femme Shep look from Mass Effect 3. She's now back in Mass Effect 1. They've touched up by hand all the main characters. Everybody from, Tali and Garrus and stuff. I was going to go into something else there, but yeah, they basically made a point of saying they wanted to touch on as many main characters as possible. Anderson was shown off, has like a sort of redone kind of face and stuff like that. So what do you think of all that stuff so far? And then I'm going to get to something even bigger.
Well, a few questions and comments come to mind at first. First, you mentioned a lot of changes there to Mass Effect 1 and its combat and its cover system and stuff. Do we still have the overheating mechanic? Is that still intact? Is that still as it was? Or have we moved to the 2 and 3's ammo system?
I would assume that they've got rid of it. They didn't mention that, actually. The way that they showed off the gameplay of Mass Effect 1 to us was this kind of like in prototype version where it was Shepard running around shooting targets using different weapons, but not in an actual environment. It was like a test area where it was like a checkerboard floor, checkerboard walls. And they were like, oh, this is what we're like aiming for. And so I know that the rumored release date is March 12th. That wasn't part of anything that they said to us. But I would be amazed if they hit that, because I would think that if that was the date they're going for, they would have just shown us more of proper missions. We did see some stuff of Shepard running around like on the Citadel, running around on Eden Prime, the very first level and stuff like that. But in terms of specifics, they just mentioned the HUD changes, the general sort of aiming controls. They showed him firing different weapons, and just the movement looked more like 2 and 3. Even the way that Shepard runs around like in the overworld has that sort of heft to it that they gave him in like 2 and 3. And Mark Walters as well mentioned that they changed the way the camera is like bolted to Shepard, because in Mass Effect 1 it would jut around if you were going up and down different elevations. It would jut with you, which is why 1 feels weird if you go back to it, whereas they got rid of that in 2 and 3. In terms of another big thing though, they've overhauled the Mako, the feel of the Mako, which will be divisive. I love the Mako.
Yes.
I love you. Yeah, the original bouncy, stupid Mako. They said that they understand fans, obviously some fans like that, but at the same time it was quite over the top and realistic. So they wanted to go back to it, and they've sort of grounded it. I guess made it a bit more like Mass Effect Andromeda's one. They showed it in motion, and they still showed it doing like a big boost jump. But I just assume that it won't be as, because honestly, if you were inside that thing, you would just be ping-ponging around left, right, and center.
I love that stuff back in the day.
Yeah, same.
So good.
And the other thing that they've completely overhauled is the character creator, and there's now a universal character creator for all three games. So, you know, they said that over time they got better at letting you make characters in Mass Effect 2 and 3, so they've designed this new sort of universal character creator with all new hair and face options, and that you can then just make your Shepard in the first game and carry them all the way through. And they said that they made a point of, you know, making sure that your custom Shepard looks like they belong, like, you know, they look like they're as sort of handcrafted as the main characters themselves, which if you play the original Mass Effect, then you know that those custom versions of Shepard looked a little bit weird, like could sort of have a very flat face.
That is so cool, because I remember getting Mass Effect for the first time and being so excited. And obviously, because it's an RPG, I wanted to create my own custom character. And I'm not lying when I tell you guys that the Shepard that I made the first time I tried that character customization suite was just the ugliest man alive. Like, there was no redeeming that dude. He should not have been in charge of a ship, not just because he was ugly, but he looked evil as well. You know what I mean? He looked not only just completely
strange.
Yeah, but he looked very evil and not human. He looked like, you know, in Men in Black 1, where that monster is wearing the man's skin. He looked a bit like that. So to get this bit of information, to know that I'm going to be able to create, you know, an interesting, my own version of Shepard, whether it's male or female, and not just have to stick with that template, which I just use for every single playthrough after that. Like, I just use the default Shepard every single time. Like, that's cool. I'm really interested to see what people come up with that new suite.
Yeah, I mean, they showed a couple of examples of like newer Shepherds that just did look better rendered. One of them sort of had cornrows, which is like one of the new hair options. I kind of hope there's like long flow. I hope you can get like a big long flowing mane, like He-Man style. But yeah, so there's that. Another big thing for Mass Effect 1 is that they went in and redesigned a lot of the environments. In terms of some of the examples that they gave, is there's a lot of background stuff being done, like literally backgrounds of the environments get given more detail. An example was Pharos, the sort of skyscraper place that you go to at the beginning of Mass Effect 1. They wanted to kind of emphasize that, like, you know, in there has been this whole sort of like clash culture war with Exogeny being there for a while and then leaving, and you had all these like skyscrapers that were on fire in the background. So they did a lot more of that. They fleshed out a lot more. You can just see a lot more sort of devastation, and it gives it more of like a sense of place or whatever. They were going for that whole approach. They also showed at the very beginning when Sovereign leaves Eden Prime, when the ship leaves in the distance, they've just rotated the sun so that the sun is now behind Sovereign. Because they said that they like the idea of that sort of showing off a lot of the you know, advanced texture work that they've done, the reflections and things like that. And so it's kind of the general mentality that they got across, other than, you know, overhauling the feel of Mass Effect 1, was to kind of reapproach the trilogy in terms of like, we want to just like touch it up, just sort of like, Mark Walters referred to having developer angst when those games shipped, and he's like, you know, obviously Mass Effect 1 shipped, they got so much better with 2 and 3. And then it's a case of like, you know, going back and going like, well, we don't want to change it too much, but we can sort of touch these things up. Speaking of touching things up, Mass Effect 3's ending, the extended cut, is now the standard ending. This was hilarious because they did a Q&A thing at the end, and I really wanted to just ask, like, what the hell was it like going back to the end of Mass Effect 3? How much of that was intentional? How much of it got in the way with EA? And obviously the question I asked was just sort of like, what was it like going back to the divisive elements of Mass Effect 3? And is the extended cut now canon? And Walters said that he would answer the sort of second part of that and said, yeah, like, to so many players, the extended cut is their ending. And so now that will just be the ending. So I guess like the whatever version with the original one, the Star Child stuff, the vague sort of questions, the stuff that you couldn't say to him in the moment, it'll just go into the extended cut, and that makes way more sense. Plus, alongside that, across all three games, every single piece of DLC is included, like everything.
Yeah.
From the Mass Effect Genesis comic that they put in at the start of 2, or in between 1 and 2 that was also accessible in 2, to all the promotional armor, like you can get the Blood Dragon armor from Dragon Age.
Great.
You can get like all the different weapons and stuff. There's all the story DLC. Javik will be there from the beginning. You know, there's the Leviathan DLC, there's the Batarian stuff in the first game. Like, they obviously are doing the whole, it's literally everything in one place style thing, which makes so much sense. And the last thing for Mass Effect 3 is that they've removed the multiplayer. They said that they are thinking of it as a single player focused thing. And so, you know, they said the servers are still live. If you want to play Mass Effect 3 multiplayer, you can obviously play Andromeda, but they weren't going to focus on that here. So what do you think of the changes to ME3?
Well, first off, that's a lot of information to take in, and it's all mostly positive, in my opinion. The multiplayer thing, I can totally see why they're not spending time doing that, because, you know, it ultimately, while I thought it was good, it's did kind of feel a little bit tacked on, but at the same time, I wonder how that like affects the galactic readiness or whatever it was called system in Mass Effect 3. Yeah, when obviously a huge part of that game is getting resources, courting allies for the attack or the pushback against the Reapers and stuff. And part of how you got that galactic readiness up was by playing the multiplayer. So I wonder if they've, you know, counted that in the game where you get more of those points from doing the side missions or something. I guess that's something we're going to have to see. Mass Effect 3 having the extended edition is like just the regular version now. That does make sense. You know, they put a lot of effort into getting that out. And I think to a lot of people that was already kind of canon anyway in their minds. The stuff about Mass Effect 1, I don't want to harp on it too much because obviously I haven't seen loads of it at the moment, and it's, the jury's still out, of course. But it is interesting the changes they made, in my opinion, because even the subtle tweaks, like changing where the sun is, for me does change the mood of those planets and those sequences that were highlighted. So I'm fascinated to see how that affects, you know, the impact of those moments. Yeah, whether they're going to go for epic as opposed to kind of moody and atmospheric. But I guess that's just, you know, part and parcel of getting these remasters. There are always changes like this. And I suppose ultimately I feel like now, we talk about this every single time we do a video on remasters or even remakes or whatever, I feel like because the older games are kind of like quite still accessible really, you know, you can get them on Game Pass I think, or at least you could for a little while, they're definitely backwards compatible. If you want like a version of that game, of that franchise, you can go back and kind of like play those, where here I am interested in those differences, even if they might not gel with me personally as a big Mass Effect fan. I think it's cool to see, especially like Mac Walters said, like with this developer angst and this developer hindsight, things that they maybe wanted to do with the original games but didn't have time to, didn't have the resources, didn't have the know-how or whatever. And now they're kind of like making those tweaks. Now that's fascinating from a kind of authorship perspective to see what they might have done had they had all this experience that they've had now. It looks like it's a really cool project. And I'm, as a Mass Effect fan who hasn't played the DLC because I just couldn't afford them when I was younger, like that's the big exciting thing for me. I've played some of them. But I played some of them. I played, I played the connective tissue between 2 and 3, and I think I played maybe the Citadel DLC in it.
Did you play Lair of the Shadow Broker?
But I didn't really play Lair of the Shadow Broker. I had to watch all of those cutscenes on YouTube because I couldn't afford them, you know what I mean? So I'm excited to go through all that stuff as a huge fan and be able to play it like front to back, all the DLC, all of that additive stuff, the complete story. Like that's the thing that I'm so excited to finally be able to do.
Yeah, I mean, one point as well is that they said that this began development in 2019. That was when the sort of idea of it coming together was. And in terms of, you know, if you're a hardcore Mass Effect fan, you've been following BioWare over the years, you're wondering the specific personnel that are on this. You know, Mac Walters is the project director. They also mentioned that they went back and got some of the original like art directors and the art designers and stuff to look at this idea of like, oh, if we rotate the sun, if we change part of this environment, you know, what does that change? And is that being signed off by the original people? And it seems like they tried to do as much of that as possible. Obviously, you know, like around about two years is a pretty tight development time. But the Mass Effect trilogy is pretty phenomenal as it is. Like for me, it was just the problem was always with three. It was always with siphoning off all those story points into separate paid pieces of DLC, which if you fold them into the main story and you have things like Leviathan and Javik with you from the beginning, that should pretty much ensure that Mass Effect 3 lands so much stronger than it ever did in 2012. So I'm fascinated, like, it feels like Mass Effect has always been this incredible sci-fi franchise, and I've always loved it. Like, I went back through one a couple of months ago, and I was still like, I'm in awe of this. Like, I still absolutely adore it. And I just hope that this becomes like the definitive way to play these games. The very last thing to mention is that it will be running at 4K on all systems. It's 60 FPS and 4K on the PS4 Pro, Xbox One X, and all of the newer systems, the PS5 and both series consoles. They're aiming for 4K HDR on everything, and then it's just whether you get a higher frame rate if you play on the newer systems. So there's that, but everything seemed pretty damn cool. I hope that hopefully by the time this goes up, the trailer should be there as well. But having also seen that trailer, I think that it's worth pointing out a few extra things. Because even when I was watching the trailer, the one that they're about to put up, I kind of just thought, like, you guys aren't really getting across how much you've done like to Mass Effect 1. Like, you know, it looks touched up, but you're always going up against the version of Mass Effect or the version of an old game that exists in people's minds. And I think a lot of people will have already mentally upscaled these games anyway. So you kind of need more side-by-sides, you need, you know, the reality of someone saying, look, Mass Effect 1's going to play completely differently, and maybe you forgot about the back button being the grenade button because it seems that they've changed things. So yeah, that's everything that I picked up on sitting in this particular BioWare Q&A type thing. And let us know what you think down in the comments. For now, I've been Scott from WhatCulture.com.
I've been Josh from WhatCulture.com.
I'll catch you next time.
Bye.